I think time is up. So let me start. Welcome everybody. My name is Rastislav Savo. I'm from Pantone Tech Company, and today I'll be presenting something about network flow monitoring in Kubernetes using the ContivVPP CNI and the Elastic Stack. Before I begin, something about me. I'm a staff engineer at Pantone.tech. We are doing some software solutions, mostly for the networking industry. Previously, I was personally focused mostly on network manageability protocols using NetConvLink, currently working on cloud-native related projects, and I have contributions to several open source projects, such as this repo. And three that I'll be mentioning throughout this talk, FDIO, mostly in the GoVPP sub-project, Legato, and ContivVPP. Okay, let me start with some motivation. Why do we actually need network monitoring in our Kubernetes clusters? Well, at the very minimum, you would at least need to be alerted and notified whenever there is some issue in your cluster, I mean networking related issue. That might be some fatal issue which would cause that one of your nodes does not work, or just congestion, packet drop, etc. Also, you want to monitor your cluster in order to identify networking bottlenecks. If you have large-scale deployment with many pods throughout many nodes, you want to deploy them in a way that the traffic is distributed equally in the cluster. Of course, another motivation could be detection of malicious activities or attacks, and their investigation, if possible. And the fourth motivation that is interesting for me is the deployments of CNFs, cloud native network functions, which is network functions deployed as a set of microservices, let's say router or some net or firewall running as a pod or as a chain of pods. Okay, now what are the current options for some network monitoring in Kubernetes? It's pretty much metrics. Moving the CNIs expose some Prometheus metrics. Some of them actually do not export the most interesting data, which would be packet counters or byte counters on individual pod interfaces. Some of them export just some internal state and error rate, etc. But for instance, the CNI that I'll be talking about, the ContivVPP, exports quite nice metrics. I'll show you how it looks. Then you can rely on some service mesh in case that you have service mesh solution running in your cluster. But that would give you pretty much the view on the application layer. Sometimes you need to see what's happening on lower networking layers as well. Then you can do your own metrics. You can monitor network interfaces in individual pods namespaces and process them. But the most important thing that I wanted to mention is that metrics are usually not enough. For metrics, as you can see on this slide, which is a ContivVPP CNI deployment, which exports the Prometheus metrics for each pod interface. For metrics, you can spot some issue. You can, for instance, see that on the top graph, we have some spike in error drop, so you can get an alert that something is happening in your network, but you don't really know what is happening. When you get the alert, you can go to the node, explore what's happening, but if that goes to normal, you again have no ability to figure out what was happening. Maybe it was an attack. You don't know. Okay, I'm actually show you Prometheus exported metrics of ContivVPP CNI shown in Grafana. As I said, for each port, you can see, for instance, what was the outgoing and incoming traffic rate. You can filter based on the pod names, etc. So these are metrics. But if I said that metrics may not be enough, then what we can do in order to get some better visibility into our network? Well, in traditional network, the networks you would use the protocols such as NetFlow or IPFIX, which are, I think, well known in the networking industry. The NetFlow or IPFIX protocols work based on three components in your network. You would have flow exporter, which exports some information about each network flow that it sees, and the network flow is usually an n-tuple identifying the individual network connection, which consists of source and destination IPs, protocol, type of service, and ports, of course, data and packet counters and timestamp. So in a traditional network, the flow exporter would be either router or a switch or a specialized hardware probe. The flow collector would be some software which is responsible for collecting all the flow records that it gets from all the flow exporters. And then you would have some analysis tool which pretty much analyzes all the data received and stored by the collector. Okay, in Kubernetes, we can actually use the same principles. We'll just use different components as our flow collectors, exporters, and analysis tools. So in Kubernetes, our flow exporter may be a CNI plugin, because the CNI plugin is actually our router or switch, which forwards all the traffic between the pods on the same node and between the nodes. You cannot actually export the flows on the routers that would or switches that would interconnect your nodes, because the traffic between the nodes is actually usually encrypted or it's encapsulated in some tunnel. So that's another reason why the CNI would be the right component for acting as a flow exporter. So the CNI for exporting the flows. Now what we can use as a flow collector and the storage and analysis tool. Since we are in the cloud native world, we could use, for instance, the ELK stack, which stands for three open source components that go together and create a whole infrastructure together. One is the Logstash, the other one is Elasticsearch, and the third is Kibana. So the Logstash can act as a flow collector. It already supports the processing of IPFIX and NetFlow information. The Elasticsearch we can use for two things pretty much. That's the storage. And it can act as a search engine for all the stored flows. Elasticsearch is very good at horizontal scaling, so we don't have to be worried about the scaling issues, because if one Elasticsearch instance is not enough, we can scale it horizontally into a cluster. And for the analysis, we can use Kibana, which would pretty much be our UI that allows us to search in our flow storage. Okay. For the proof of concept that I'll show in a second, I used one of the CNIs that are available. The CNI is called ContivVPP. The CNI is really focused on two things. One is speed and low latency, because it runs an FDI or VPP instance on each node. VPP is a very fast data plane in a user space, which its name or shortcut comes from vector packet processing, which means that instead of processing the packets one by one, it tries to process multiple packets in one vector at once. That's why it's very fast. Also, it relies on DPDK for accessing the NIC on the node. And it also supports interface called MIMIF, memory interface, which is able to forward the packet between the VPP instance and the pod through shared memory. To use the MIMIFs, you need to have a special application running in the pod, either another VPP instance or some application that would use the MIMIF client library. So by default, you get the tab interfaces between the VPP and the pod, but in case that you would need high performance, for instance, for CNFs deployments, you can use MIMIFs. Well, that's actually the second second aim of the ContivVPP CNI. It's really aimed for the cloud native network function deployments, because it supports the memory interfaces. It is able to connect multiple network interfaces towards the pods, and it already supports some simple service chaining between those secondary interfaces. And for this demonstration, the best thing is that VPP already supports IPFIX, so it pretty much just needs to be enabled on all the interfaces that go towards the pods. Okay, this slide shows how this can be all integrated together in case that we wanted to upstream this IPFIX support to the CNI. So pretty much you need to write a ContivVPP IPFIX plugin, which would hook to the pod at and delete events and enable IPFIX on the pod interface on VPP. The way how ContivVPP does it, it is of course written in Go, as I think all the CNIs, but ContivVPP internally uses the Legato VPP agent to program VPP. Legato IO and its VPP agent is a very interesting project, especially if you are interested in CNFs. It pretty much provides a production-ready CNF that can be just deployed and configured. It contains a Docker container, which contains an VPP in it, plus its management agent, which provides several cloud-native northbound API ways of programming it, such as gRPC, REST, ATCD, etc. And ContivVPP uses it as an internal dependency to program VPP. And of course, the Legato agent then calls binary APIs which program the VPP instance. Okay, so once we have VPP acting as a vSwitch between the pods, thanks to the ContivVPP CNI, we have enabled the IP fix on each of the pod interfaces. We need to deploy the Logstash, Elasticsearch, and Kibana. For this, we can actually use an existing project called Elastiflow, which is really ready to use out-based IP fix collector and analyzer solution that you just need to run. For this demonstration, I just packaged that into Docker containers. I wrote the deployment YAML files for Kubernetes, and all these three components run as pods in my Kubernetes cluster. The VPP instance is then configured with an IP address of the Logstash pod, where it sends all the flow information. Yeah, this shows pretty much the result, but I'll try to show it live if I manage that with one hand. So this is how you can see the flows in your cluster in Kibana. As I said, the flows were exported by VPP, sent to the Logstash, which saved them in Elasticsearch, and Kibana just accesses those stored data in Elasticsearch. These dashboards come with the Elasticflow solution. But of course, you can write your own dashboards if this is not enough or you wanted to see something more specific for your deployment. So let me see if I can show you this in my browser. Or yeah, let me start with in a console. So this is my cluster running on my laptop. I have already deployed Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. They are running as pods in here. And apart from them, I have the ContivVPP CNI running, which you can know by seeing this ContivVPP, this ContivVSwitch pod, which is actually the vSwitch which processes all the packets between the pods. I can access the VPP console, which can show, which allows you to type some debugging commands. I can show you the individual interfaces that are going towards the pods. You can see there is a lot of packets coming through them. Another interesting fact may be our flow probes. Yeah, it seems that I have somehow managed it to disable it in the meantime, but never mind. All the flows were actually exported into Elasticsearch before I disabled it. I can show you one more thing that I have not mentioned. The ContivVPP CNI also provides the kubeproxy functionality on VPP. So in case that you have ContivVPP deployed in your cluster, the NAT that usually happens between the pods does not happen using kubeproxy, but using the VPP, which we can see here, show NAT for four static mappings. So these are the NAT rules programmed on the VPP, which do all the netting for the Kubernetes services deployed in my cluster. On the bottom, you can see the entries that handle the kubeDNS service. So the kubeDNS cluster IP is load balanced to two local IPs which are the IPs of the kubeDNS pods. Okay, so let me go back to Kibana, which accesses the flows stored in the Elasticsearch. Just briefly show you how does it look like and what you can see. So this is a top-end view. In my cluster, I don't have any specific application running. Pretty much it's just those pods that you have seen. So the ELK pods and the core DNS pods. But yeah, you have the ability to see on a graph which is which are the most active services. You can filter out by service ports, for instance. So if I was interested on HTTPS, I would see just kubeDNS communication. Another view could be this nice view on the flows in the cluster, where I can see which pod communicates with ones. So for instance, this one, this red one, was Kibana accessing the Elasticsearch pod, and this yellow was Elasticflow, or Logstash sending the traffic into the Elasticsearch. There is also a GeoIP view in case that I had a cluster that would be accessible from outside. I would see from where my clients are coming, and we can also dig into some traffic details. For instance, if I was interested in clients ordered by packets per second or bits per second, again, you could filter out by services, server IPs, or server names, and the same for the client. And the last one, which I would show, is an actual flow records, which are stored in the Elasticsearch. So this is basically the raw data that is in the Elasticsearch and from which all the dashboards are generated. So let me open one. Yeah, okay. So this is the raw flow data as Elasticsearch received from Logstash. So all the information about what was the client IP address, also translated to its hostname thanks to DNS working in our cluster. The same for the destination, which was the server IP, and some more information about the TCP that was going on to that flow, and the port numbers, flex, etc. Of course, timestamps and byte rate. Okay, now let me go back to my presentation. Yeah, so what you have seen was just a single single node cluster with one Logstash and Elastic and Kibana instances. For real world deployment, as I said, you would usually want clustered deployment of Elastic, and ideally you would want to have one Logstash instance running on each node to limit the traffic between the VPP and the Logstash, because in case that you have too many connections in your cluster, all the flow information coming from VPP to Logstash, that can be quite heavy load. Of course, we don't have to scale Kibana, because that's just an UI accessing the Elasticsearch. I was also talking about the MemIV interface that VPP supports. To recap, it is a special type of interface which allows you to forward the packet between the VPP, which runs in the user space, to a pod, bypassing the kernel through the shared memory. But for that, you need to have an application that is MIME aware, which means that the application needs to use the MIME library. We can actually use that to build a more lightweight flow collector than the Logstasis. We could, for instance, use the Cloudflare's GoFlow project and just integrate it with the MIME library in Go. And in that case, all the flows that are coming from VPP to our flow collector may go through shared memory. Yep, and that would be it from my side. I think I have a few minutes left, so I would maybe mention one more thing that is important from the point of view of CNFs, cloud native network functions, and that is that ContivVPP supports pods with multiple interfaces, which can be deployed as follows. So pretty much in the pod definition, you would just tell ContivVPP that you are requesting an additional interface, and you give it the name of the interface, the type of the interface, which is stub in this case, and the network, which is stub in this case, which means not connected to the default pod network. This is how we request additional interface. And what's important is that the IP fix can be enabled on those interfaces as well. Also, in case you wanted to deploy MIME aware CNF, it would look like this. Again, you would define that you want the custom interface, give it the name. In this case, you would give it the type MIME, and that's it. Conti would connect additional interface and enable IPFix on that interface as well. That's very important from the point of view of cloud native network functions, that this can work on all the interfaces inside of the pod. And yeah, if I'm talking about CNFs, I would just show you maybe one more thing. So as I have told you, those secondary interfaces in this particular case would live in stub network, which means they wouldn't be connected anywhere. You can define a service function chain, which would actually interconnect the pod with an additional interface with another pod with an additional interface, in this case on L2 level, which may be useful for various networking deployments. Okay, I think that's it. We have 5 minutes, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask. I'll give you a mic.
I have two questions. One is, I see the ContivVPP hasn't updated for about 1 year. Do you have plans or roadmaps for the ContivVPP?
You mean ContivVPP was not updated?
Yeah. I see, you can see from the GitHub.
Yeah.
The project seems stopped update.
Yeah, I need to mention one thing. When we are talking about ContivVPP, you need to be sure to look at this repository, which is really ContivVPP, because there are many Contiv repositories which pretty much contained the old Contiv net plugin CNI. That one is not supported anymore, but ContivVPP is still being developed. So there are pretty much two different CNIs. There was old Contiv. The development on that one has stopped, but there is ContivVPP, which now uses the same name, but is completely different. And it is based on the VPP, VPP instances running on each node. And that's what I was talking about. And as you can see, that one is active, updated 4 days ago.
Yeah. Another question is, I see you record, you have a record in log stage for each packet.
Sir?
You have a record in log stash for mm-hmm. each packet.
No, not each packet.
And what's the policy for recording in log stash?
Yeah, so the way how IPFix or NetFlow protocols work is that you are not saving each one packet, you are saving only information about each network flow. So if you have a TCP connection which transmits 2 gigabytes through it, you would have just one record of a few bytes telling what was the client IP, server IP, timestamps, ports, data, bytes of that flew through the connection, but that's it. No each packet, only flow information.
And so what's the period for your update to the log stash? The intervals, yeah.
Yeah, so
is it configurable?
So what I've shown is really just a proof of concept. It is not yet upstreamed into ContivVPP.
Yeah.
It is all configurable on VPP side, so you can configure how fast you want to send the flows from VPP into the flow collector.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. What's the difference or relationship between Contiv and the ContivVPP?
Only the name. And maybe some of the team members of old Contiv are also the members of the ContivVPP team, but from the CNI point of view, only the name is the same. ContivVPP is completely new CNI, which just uses the name.
Hi. I have actually two questions. First, have you any numbers on the performance drawbacks you receive with your stuff? And the second, how do you compare yourself to something like Weavescope?
In this case, you mean the ContivVPP CNI performance number or the IPFix?
If I just implement, let's keep Logstash and Elasticsearch aside, mm-hmm. just installing your IPFix stuff, how big would be the performance impact, just roughly?
Yeah, so if you are comparing just the CNIs compared to Calico or whatever else, if you use tap interfaces between the VPP and the pod, which are there by default because the application just uses sockets to communicate, the performance is, I would say, similar. If you just go pod to pod, not through service. Where is the difference? There is a better scalability with many Kubernetes services. You may know if you deploy thousands of Kubernetes services, which would program as IP table rules, that would be a lot of overhead on the kernel, and it would take a lot of CPU cycles just to handle all the NAT entries. This is where VPP shine, because there is almost no performance drawback on VPP. And then if you used the memive interfaces, which as I said need a special type of application, then we are talking about 8 mega packets per second between the pod and the vSwitch.
Do you have some comparison data between them?
I don't think we have anything upstream in ContivVPP that would be available, but there is a FDIO VPP CSIT test results, which actually tests very similar thing as we are doing, and that is one vSwitch running on the node, several containers interconnected through Memif, and they have numbers for several different chains between the containers, reswitch one CNF and back to reswitch, and then reswitch CNF, 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 back to reswitch, etc. That's available on FDIO website. Sorry, I think we need to finish, but we can talk afterwards. I can show you something. Yep. Thank you.